Hydrus is a small and relatively faint constellation in the southern sky. The name Hydrus is Latin for male water snake. Hydrus is not to be confused with Hydra, which is a different constellation. Hydra represents a mythical sea serpent. It is much larger in size, has ancient origins, and can be seen at a different time of the year. Hydrus is located near the south celestial pole, and it is classified as a modern-day constellation. In this video, we will review how to find Hydrus in the night sky, the history of this star pattern, and examine bright stars and celestial objects that lie within the boundaries of this constellation. Hydrus the Water Snake is classified as a modern constellation. It was first originated by Dutch explorers as a way to navigate this area of the sky that was new to them. The name means male water snake in Latin, and Hydrus can be used to find the south celestial pole. It's also classified as a seasonal constellation. So when can you see Hydrus? It's best seen in the southern hemisphere. In fact, anywhere you go in the southern hemisphere, you would be able to find this constellation. The best month to see it is in November, and it is possible to see Hydrus from the northern hemisphere, but you have to be very close to the equator. Hydrus is only visible from 8 degrees north latitude. So, not many people in the northern hemisphere would be able to see this. You'd most likely need to travel to the southern hemisphere. The best way to find it is to look for the large and small Magellanic clouds and the bright star Achenar in the constellation Eridanus. The stars are fairly faint, mostly of third magnitude, but you really want to use the celestial objects around this constellation to find it. Let's review the pattern of Hydrus the Water Snake. Here is the official star map of Hydrus. And you can see it makes a triangle pattern in this star map, but keep in mind you can see other celestial maps and see different patterns as well. The main things to point out here are the small Magellanic cloud, and then this right here is the large Magellanic cloud. And here's just a different view. The other things that you might notice on this star map is this bright star. And this bright star is known as Achenar, and it's in the constellation of Eridanus, which is the river. Achenar is a really cool system, by the way. It's a binary star system in which the main star, Achenar A, has this extreme rotational speed, so it causes it to be flattened at the poles. It's located about 139 light years away, and it's the ninth brightest star in the night sky. Achenar really needs its own video, which will eventually be coming, so let's get back to Hydrus. Some other things you can notice are all the constellations that are surrounding it. You have Phoenix, Tucana, Octans, Mensa, Reticulum, and Horologium. So there are lots of constellations in this area, most of which are classified as modern constellations. Here is another star map that shows Hydrus. Right here, we'll take a look at this map a little bit later when we look at the different celestial objects that are located within this star pattern. Hydrus can also be used to find the south celestial pole. If you take a look at this map, here you have Hydrus, Centaurus, and the Southern Cross. So you want to use Beta Centauri in Centaurus and draw a line south to Alpha Hydri. Alpha Hydri is right next to Achenar, but if you draw a line between these two stars, the midpoint of that line is right next to the south celestial pole. Now let's get some practice finding Hydrus in the night sky. As you look at this photo, there are probably some things that really stand out to you. For example, the Milky Way spans across the entire sky. You have a few bright stars throughout this picture, and then you have these two cloudy regions. These aren't clouds, of course, but they're rather dwarf galaxies, and they're called the Large Magellanic Cloud and Small Magellanic Cloud. These two celestial objects are what you want to use when finding Hydrus in the night sky. And just to give you some more orientation here, these two bright stars are Alpha and Beta Centauri. These are the two brightest stars in Centaurus, and then right here is the Southern Cross. So, another object I want you to pay attention to is this bright star right there. That's Achenar. We've talked about that star before. It's a binary star system. And you want to use this bright star and these two objects to help you find Hydrus. And Hydrus is faint. It's not an easy constellation to find because its stars are only of third magnitude. Now we're going to zoom into this area so we can get a closer look at where Hydrus is. So again, here's where the Milky Way is. You have Alpha and Beta Centauri and the Southern Cross right here, and then the Small Magellanic Cloud and the Large Magellanic Cloud. So for me to find this constellation, what I do is I kind of look for the brightest stars near each of these objects, and then right here. So here is Achenar, and the brightest star to that is right there. And then here is the Large Magellanic Cloud. The brightest star of Hydrus is right there. And then this is the Small Magellanic Cloud, and this is the brightest star right there. These are the things you want to use in order to find Hydrus, which I will point out for you. Reminder, it is a faint constellation, so you really have to use the celestial objects around it to help you find this constellation. And remember, you can also use Hydrus to help you find the South Celestial Pole. If you draw an imaginary line between Beta Centauri, right here, all the way to Alpha Hydri, the midpoint of that line is the South Celestial Pole. I had to get creative with finding constellations in the Southern Hemisphere, especially since photos of the Southern constellations are scarce in my experience. I also do not live in the Southern Hemisphere, and I've never seen Hydrus before, so I had to teach myself how to find it. And my solution to this challenge was using Google Earth. I started visiting observatories in the Southern Hemisphere with the hopes that I could find somebody who took a night sky picture at that particular location. And lo and behold, I found one. Here at the La Silla Observatory in Chile, it's operated by the European Southern Observatory. And when I dropped down to this point, I found this gorgeous photo. And I'm just so thankful for this person to help me and many others see what the southern sky looks like. I use Google Earth all the time in my classroom, so I thought this was just kind of a different and new way for me to learn the southern constellations. I've never had to do this before. So, Mr. Lucchesi, if you're out there, thank you so much for taking this gorgeous photo. Now let's review over the bright stars that sit within the boundaries of Hydrus. The first one is called Beta Hydri, and it's the brightest star of this constellation that represents the tail of the snake. This star is very similar to our own sun, but it's a little bit further along in its age. It has begun to grow into a giant star, and it's three times more luminous than the sun, but it has this just about the same mass of the sun. It's estimated to be 24 light years away, and astronomers once thought there was an exoplanet around this system, but it has been unconfirmed later on. Beta Hydri, I also learn, is a very popular subject for many sci-fi books. This is probably because it is so similar to our own sun, and it's very close at only 24 light years away. So it was really cool as I was learning about this star to learn about the different sci-fi works that are written around this star. So I can't wait to dive into that. The next star I'd like to review is Alpha Hydri, and we talked about this one a little bit because you can use Alpha Hydri, draw this line right to, oops, right here. This is Beta Hydri. So you draw a line from here to here, and then right in the middle of that imaginary line is where the South Celestial Pole would be. And Alpha Hydri is an F-type subgiant star. It's estimated to be 71 light years away. It's two times the mass of the sun, three times the radius, and 21 times more luminous. It's the star that is closest to Achenar. Okay, so that's how you're going to be able to find Alpha Hydri. And one interesting fact I found is that this star emits X-rays that are very similar to Altair, where you have lots of X-ray emission around the equator. It is the second brightest star in Hydrus, despite its alpha designation.
Let's review over the celestial objects that sit within the boundaries of Hydrus. There's a lot to unpack here, so let's get started.
The first object to look at is NGC 602, and this is an open star cluster that's embedded inside of a nebula called N90. And N90 is similar to the Orion Nebula, but it has one major difference. It's about 100 times farther away, but both are star-forming type of regions, and they're interesting for astronomers to study. The James Webb Space Telescope recently took a look at this area. You can see the rim of the picture is N90, and then inside are the star cluster NGC 602. And then here is another composite image. Here we have visible light from the Hubble Space Telescope with infrared data from the Spitzer Space Telescope and X-ray data as well from the Chandra. Astronomers use different telescopes and instruments to create composite images because each type of telescope is sensitive to a different wavelength, and it reveals different aspects of celestial objects. These images, when combined, provide a more comprehensive view of what the universe looks like, and it showcases details that no one single telescope can capture on its own. Another object to observe would be NGC 1466, located in this area of Hydrus. And this is a globular star cluster estimated to be 130,000 light years away. Another object to see is NGC 1511. This is a barred spiral galaxy estimated to be 65 million light years away, and it spans 83,000 light years across. Another object located in the constellation of Hydrus is called the White Rose Galaxy, and it is a lenticular galaxy that's estimated to be 345 million light years away. It has properties of both elliptical and spiral galaxies, and it also goes by the name PGC 6240. And what's interesting about this galaxy is that its name comes from the resemblance of a white rose, and just like the petals of a rose, the galaxy has these shells of gas that surround its bright center, and some of the shells are closer to the center, and the ones that are farther away appear to be disconnected from the main galaxy. And I just can't help but envision petals of a rose falling off a flower when I look at this picture of the galaxy. Another fascinating thing about this galaxy are the ages of its globular clusters. They have different ages based upon the group that you're looking at. There's a group that's about 400 million years old. There's an older group about 1 billion years old, and then another group that's even older than a billion years old. And the two that are younger are the same age as these rings that surround the galaxy. So scientists hypothesize that the younger groups and shells form during bursts of star formation after this galaxy merged with another. And as you look closely in this photo, you can see thousands of galaxies in the background as well. Now let's review over the mythology of this constellation, or rather I should say the history of this constellation, because it doesn't have an ancient mythological story associated with it. Unlike many other constellations, Hydrus is not associated with any ancient mythology. It was introduced in the modern era primarily for navigational purposes. Hydrus was one of the 12 southern constellations proposed at the end of the 16th century by Dutch navigators Peter Keyser and Frederik de Houtman. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. It also appeared on a celestial globe created by Petrus Planckius in 1598. Hydrus symbolizes the sea snakes that the Dutch explorers would have encountered throughout their expeditions. The constellation was also introduced by Johann Bayer in his 1603 publication of the star atlas Uranometria. Hydrus resembles a rearing snake here, with its head erect and its body twisted into this sinuous shape. Plancius was a very important person in the Golden Age of Dutch and Netherlands mapping, which occurred around 1570s to the 1670s. He truly was a pioneer in the field of celestial cartography. And besides making maps, he also wrote journals, made navigational tools, and came up with a new way to determine longitude. In 1595, Plancius directed Peter Dirksoen Kaiser to make observations of the southern sky and fill in the blanks around the south celestial pole for European maps. We've come to the end of our video about Hydra, so let's review everything we've learned so far. Its name comes from the Latin term meaning male sea serpent, and it's best seen in October and November, and especially if you're in the southern hemisphere. It's classified as a seasonal constellation, and the best way to find it is to look for the large and small Magellanic clouds and the bright star Achenar. It has a bright star of its own called Beta Hydri, and it has a variety of celestial objects. So let me know in the comments below, have you ever seen Hydrus, the male sea serpent, before? Is it easy to point out for those of you that live in the southern hemisphere?
Hydrus is definitely a constellation I hope to see in my own lifetime. Thanks for watching. If you would like to learn more about basic astronomy concepts, be sure to subscribe. I explore topics such as constellations, stars, celestial objects, and events. Visit my channel or website to learn more.